Well, good morning, everybody. I'm out at the plane, and as of this week, I'm grounding it for some maintenance. So whenever you plan on flying in transponder airspace, every 24 months, you have to get your altimetry devices recertified. Now, in the case of my aircraft, that means the transponder, the altimeter, and the encoder need to be recertified every 24 months. Now, that maintenance item is due this month. However, next month, my ELT is also due, so my emergency locator transmitter is also due for its 2-year recertification. And rather than keep both of these items out of phase and take my aircraft down this month out of operation and next month and have to make 2 different trips to the avionics shop, I'm going to bring both of those tasks in the same phase and do all of it together. So in speaking to my aircraft maintenance engineer, we laid out 2 different game plans that I could go with. I could either fly this plane to another city where there's an avionics shop, drop the keys to them, leave and come back a week later and pay a bill, have them do everything. The reason why I don't want to do that plan is I don't want to have my aircraft tied down outside at some other airport in the time while that work is being done. Now there's been a lot of thunderstorms, a lot of hail at the city that I plan to take the work to, and I don't want my aircraft tied down in all of that because for sure I'll pick up some other damage while my aircraft is there. Instead, I'm going with plan B. So plan B will involve taking those instruments out. So taking out my altimeter, my transponder, my encoder, and my ELT, boxing them up and driving them to that avionics shop a few hours away. That way I can leave just the instruments with them. They can do the bench certifications of those parts, return them to me, we can put them back in the aircraft, and my aircraft maintenance engineer can do the sign-off and the in-aircraft testing to finish off that certification. So to start things off, whoever designed this side scoop from Piper back in the day, they are amazing. I want to high-five whoever is the engineer that came up with this, because if you remove this side scoop, you can have full access to the back of the panel. There's no climbing underneath the panel or shoehorning yourself in. It's a matter of taking out these screws around here, taking out this scoop, and you have full access to all the instruments at the back. It's amazing. The altimeter was easy to remove. There was 3 screws in the front and a static line in the back. The altimeter then pulled out from the back of the panel through the hole in the side where the scoop was. Now the transponder was really easy to remove. There was 1 single set screw in the front, and then the transponder just slides out of its mounting tray. Now the altitude encoder was also easy to access. I had to take this panel off. There's only 4 screws to access the encoder behind it. Some people have a radio or whatever here, but in my case, I just have a block off plate and behind there is just a big void. So getting to the altitude encoder, nice and easy on my plane. I've got a static line I need to disconnect and a wire connector and then the mounting screws for the encoder, and that whole thing will come out. To remove the ELT, I had to pull out my seat in order to access it. From there, the ELT is held in with 2 clamps. There's also the wire connector for the ELT remote and the antenna connector. But beforehand, you need to switch the ELT off so that you don't inadvertently trigger it while you remove it from the aircraft. So now that I've got all the components on the bench, I think most people know what these components do. Obviously, your emergency locator transmitter broadcasts a signal in the event that the inertia switch is triggered, or if you manually turn it on, that's used for search and rescue of you or your aircraft. Now the transponder here, this particular one is a mode C transponder. So it gives off an identifier signal as well as altitude information to air traffic control. Now, most people know what the altimeter does. That obviously measures your pressure altitude, whatever your aircraft is flying at. Now, the encoder, I think out of all the components, if anybody has a question about what these things do, it's probably related to what this encoder does. Now, the encoder connects to the same static pressure system that the altimeter is connected to. So this blind encoder takes that physical pressure altitude information and it digitizes it. It sends that digitized signal through a wiring harness to this transponder. And that's what this transponder uses to broadcast altitude information to ATC. So all these parts are ready to be boxed up and it's off to the avionics shop. We'll be right back. So I took my components to Northern Avionics at the Springbank Airport, and I gotta say, they were fantastic. My aircraft maintenance engineer recommended them, and I can 100% see why. I called around to several other shops, and there's kind of a common theme when you get into aircraft ownership. You'll find that certain shops are more in it for the cash grab. They kind of want to turn you upside down and shake the money out of your pockets. And if you come to them as just a regular individual aircraft owner like myself with a plane like a Piper Tomahawk, you don't really matter. The money that you bring doesn't matter compared to some of the bigger accounts that they have in their business. Northern Avionics, on the other hand, very customer service oriented, and they lined up a day that I brought the components to them first thing in the morning, and here I am in the afternoon on the same day picking them up. Some of the other shops told me, well, actually one shop said the exact line, "We'll get to you when we get to you." And why would I ever use a place like that? They just want my money. They don't really care about the parts, when it'll be. They don't care about aircraft downtime. They don't care about any of that other stuff. Just shake that money out of my pockets. Northern Avionics, on the other hand, complete opposite, and I will 100% use them again. Now it's time to get these parts back into the aircraft. So I'm back at the plane with all the parts ready to install. Now it's time to get the altimeter back in the hole here, back in the instrument panel. It's kind of the opposite of delivering a kid, I think. I had to take my watch off so I don't lose it up in here. Up to my elbow, and here we are. There we go, the static line at the back of the altimeter is secure, and all three mounting screws are secure as well, so that's in. So my transponder also checked out good. Now I just want to show you this transponder before I put it into the aircraft. The pins on the back are kind of like the old NES cartridge pins. And in the front, there's the one set screw that you install it with. Now you can see this attachment lug here, how it spins when I turn the Allen key. So it is installed into the tray like this. Then when you turn the Allen key, you can see this one lug swings out. This lug engages with your transponder tray, and as you tighten the screw, this lug will draw the transponder into the tray and seat itself. Now don't be like the cash grab shop that worked on this aircraft for the previous owner shortly before I bought it. This shop didn't seat this lug properly. So what happened is I buy the plane, I fly it home, and within about a couple hours of flying time, my transponder stops working. Now my aircraft maintenance engineer took a look at it and found that they didn't seat this transponder properly. So don't be like the cash grab shop. That's literally all there was to that task. Now my emergency locator transmitter also checked out good. This particular type of emergency locator transmitter, or ELT, broadcasts on 121.5 as well as 406 megahertz. Now what that means is this is satellite trackable, and this sends off a signal with a hexadecimal code that's unique to my aircraft. So if this ELT goes off, search and rescue immediately knows that it's my aircraft that's down. The older ELTs only broadcast on 121.5, so you'd have to have search and rescue tuning in to that radio frequency and try to triangulate your position based on the strength of the signal broadcast by this ELT. So the 406 megahertz ELTs, it's a little bit of a safer option. It's kind of the newer technology coming into this world. I had to replace my ELT shortly after I bought the aircraft because the cash grab shop said my old ELT was okay, and it actually wasn't. Now this particular ELT has a switch here with an on, an off, and an arming position. So when it is installed in the aircraft and you have it set to function automatically, you have the switch set to the armed position. So this mounts under my seat. I'll install it first, then set it to the arm position, then do the function test. The reason for that is the CLT has an inertia switch inside. So if I turn this thing on to arm and I jostle it around as I'm installing it, I could potentially inadvertently trigger this ELT. And that's not what we want to do. I don't need CFB Trenton dispatching C-130s over my location to look for me. So let's just do it properly. So I will set the ELT to arm. It'll go through a series of beeps as it acquires satellite signal. Now there's a little rubber cap that goes in. It only goes in one way. It's kind of got an offset pin in the cap that holds the switch in the arm position. And then now we're done. So I'm ready for the ELT test. I got my master on, I got my radio on, intercom set. I got the radio set to 121.5. Now I'm going to activate my ELT and make sure it works. So under the aviation regulations, I can only test my ELT within the first 5 minutes of every UTC hour for no more than 5 seconds. So here we go. Okay, so now I've checked my ELT, that all works. Now it's just time for my aircraft maintenance engineer to do the final in-aircraft checks of my pitot-static system. So my aircraft maintenance engineer finished the in-aircraft checks of my plane. Now what that involved was applying a small amount of suction to my static system. What that does is it tricks the aircraft into thinking it's at a higher altitude because the air is less dense the higher you go. So it tricks the aircraft into thinking it's at a higher altitude than what it's actually at. From there, we can see the change on the altimeter. Now, what we do with that is we watch any bleed down of that suction. And if it holds, then we know that the system integrity is perfect. In my case, there is no bleed down at all, so well within any limits. And we're good to go on that front. Now with tricking the aircraft into thinking it's at a higher altitude, what we also do at that time is test the transponder and the encoder. So the encoder takes that altitude information and digitizes it, sends it to the transponder, which then is broadcast out to air traffic control. Now my aircraft maintenance engineer has the equipment that picks up not only the transponder code that you've set on the transponder, but also that altitude information. So it's broadcast from this antenna right underneath the belly of my aircraft. So we went through every digit of the transponder, making sure that every 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 0 is broadcast correctly off of every knob, and that the altitude information broadcast also matches what the altimeter reads. Now for the pitot system, a small amount of pressure is applied to the pitot system, which tricks the aircraft into thinking it's moving forward through the air, which then relays a change on my airspeed indicator. So we verified that that's working. We also monitor any bleed down, and it held perfect. So no issues there. But we are recertified now for another 2 years. It opens the door to a whole bunch of summer adventure, which I am excited about. Thank you for watching and supporting my channel, and I'll catch you on the next video.